Good afternoon. The first item of business this afternoon is portfolio questions. The first portfolio is Wellbeing, Economy, Fair Work and Energy. Any member wishing to ask a supplementary question should press the request to speak buttons during the relevant question. I can advise the Chamber we are very pressed for time across the afternoon, so the usual plea for brevity in questions and responses has an extra significance today. I hope to get in as many questions as possible. I call question number one, Jackie Bailey.
To ask the Scottish Government what proportion of the reportedly rising number of people of working age who are economically inactive are as a result of NHS waiting lists or long COVID.
Minister Richard Lockhead.
Scotland's labour market continues to perform well, with unemployment at just 3.1% in January to March 23. Economic inactivity due to illness is a challenge across not just Scotland but all of these islands. An analysis suggests that most people now inactive due to long-term sickness were already out of the labour market for another reason. Nonetheless, economic inactivity due to ill health is a key concern for the Scottish Government, and our National Strategy for Economic Transformation makes a commitment to address Scotland's labour market inactivity challenges.
Jackie Bailey.
A recent report from the Resolution Foundation has revealed that a greater proportion of Scottish economic inactivity is attributable to health problems than is the case for the rest of the UK. Now, long COVID, we know, has left many key workers, including public sector workers, carers, nurses, doctors and teachers, debilitated and unable to work. Whilst we can debate the absence of clear clinical pathways and long COVID clinics, will the Cabinet Secretary agree to investigate why so many public sector workers are losing their jobs with the consequent loss of their expertise because their employers simply lack understanding about their condition?
Minister.
Well, I think the member raises an important issue, and I wouldn't want anyone to lose their job through their employer not understanding their condition. I should point out that SALIS and Working Health Services Scotland provide return to work and occupational health services for people who have health conditions or injuries that are impacting on their work, including long COVID, to help them stay within work. And I would hope that all employers, private sector or public sector, are taking advantage of those services to help their employees. However, the Member has asked me to look into a specific issue, which I would be willing to do because I'm interested in the point that she makes, and I will certainly do that.
I can be supplementary, Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. When the COVID Recovery Committee took some evidence on long COVID from long COVID sufferers, one of the issues they identified was the difficulty they have in getting back into the workplace because of the time it is taking to get a diagnosis and then a treatment path, and they tied that to the absence of long COVID clinics in Scotland. Now, the First Minister, when he was Health Secretary, said he was open to the notion of long COVID clinics here. Can the Minister give us any indication if there's going to be any progress from the Government on actually seeing these vital clinics introduced?
Minister.
Well, again, the Member raises an important issue, and he may wish to ask Health Ministers about progress in terms of the clinics themselves, because, of course, it's up to local health boards to determine how to deliver these kind of services in their localities. And as he will be aware, the Scottish Government did make available, I think it was around £10 million for long COVID-related issues. Therefore, there is some resource being dedicated to this. But I think the Member, again, raises a powerful point, and I would urge him to raise with Health Ministers in terms of the progress with specific long COVID clinics, but it's an important issue.
Question two, Finlay Carson.
To ask the Scottish Government what its position is on what impact poor infrastructure has on the ability of Scottish businesses to succeed.
Minister Richard Lockhead.
Continuing to deliver high-quality public infrastructure is a priority for the Scottish Government, which is why the policy prospectus committed to targeting our capital spend on achieving net zero and maintaining high-quality public infrastructure and services across the country. Our capital budget for 2023-24 is just over £6 billion. The UK Government's planned real-term cuts in our capital funding over the next 5 years will significantly impact on our capital plans. However, we will work and do what we can to maximise the funding available to support employment in Scottish businesses and the economy through Scotland's infrastructure investments.
Finlay Carson.
Thank the Minister for that answer. A new poll has revealed that 9 out of 10 people want a full or partial upgrade of the A75 and A77, with 80% of those citing safety fears as their major concern. Nearly half insist that the lack of investment is not only putting off tourists visiting, but people actually moving to the southwest of Scotland. This comes on the back of an economic investment assessment that highlighted £5 billion worth of positive benefit to the economy if a proper transport infrastructure was in place. Does the SNP accept that the rural businesses and rural communities are being disproportionately let down through the dire management of Scottish infrastructure?
Minister.
I think the member, of course, raises the importance of the A75, which hopefully is recognised across the chamber and certainly by the Scottish Government. And the A75 is not only important to Scotland's economy, but also provides a critical link between Northern Ireland and the wider markets and the rest of the UK and Europe by connecting the ports to the wider trunk road network. But, of course, the member is aware, and he'd face the same challenges if, heaven forbid, his party was ever to be on these benches, of the storms, and the financial storms the Scottish Government and our budgets have had to cope with over the last decade or so, ranging from the banking crisis, the Tory party's austerity agenda, to the impact of the pandemic and Brexit, the cost of living, cost of business crisis, the war in Ukraine, and so on. And of course the impact on infrastructure projects and the speed at which they can be delivered, and also the budgets that can be made available for these very expensive infrastructure projects. So a little bit of realism, I think, would benefit the member when he's approaching these subjects. But the bottom line is, we are agreeing that the A75 requires work and is a very important trunk road for Scotland.
Briefly, Daniel Johnson.
Firstly, I welcome the new tourism minister to his place. But infrastructure in the context of tight labour markets has consequences. I speak to businesses who can identify potential workers, but they can't travel to where they live to where they need to work. So has the Scottish Government undertaken a critical analysis of key missing transport links and infrastructure that are inhibiting the current labour markets?
Minister.
Well, of course, the Scottish Government has transport plans and policies that take into account the need for people to travel to work and the importance of routes around Scotland to allow that to happen. And it's an important point the member raises, because labour shortages just now and skill shortages are very important. They're undermining some of our sectors in the economy who are actually getting demand for their products and services but can't meet that demand because they can't find the labour or the appropriate skills. In some ways, that's a sign of success in some sectors because they're doing so well, but to capitalise on that success, we need to make sure that people are available for these particular industries and sectors. So it's an important point that has to be taken into account by the Scottish Government in terms of our transport plans and wider economic policies. But once again, of course, Brexit is the issue that's most often cited to myself in terms of one of the key causes of why many sectors are facing labour shortages and the hurdles that people overseas have to jump over to come and work in Scotland, even though they've got an employer willing to employ them. So there's a range of issues that have to be addressed there.
Question three, Beatrice Wishart.
To ask the Scottish Government what discussions it's had with the UK Government about levelling up funding for Scotland's islands.
Minister Richard Lockhead.
The Scottish Government engages with the UK Government on a regular basis on the implications of its levelling up policy for Scotland, especially with regards to its impact on devolution. However, the Levelling Up Fund is a UK Government scheme which circumvents the Scottish Government. Therefore, Scottish ministers have no say in how it's allocated or what projects are supported. Shetland is the only island to have received an award thus far in the Highlands and Islands, demonstrating how poorly this fund has provided support for Scotland's islands, rural and remote places.
I thank you for that answer. I think the people of Fair Isle, for whom levelling up support has been allocated for a new ferry, would perhaps disagree with what the Minister has just said. They are very much looking forward to having their inter-island ageing ferry replaced. Short tunnels to the North Isles could be a better long-term solution, so I wonder if the Minister would seek a meeting with his relevant UK counterpart to discuss levelling up funding with a view for short tunnels between Shetland's island communities.
Minister.
Well, the member will be aware my colleague Neil Gray will be intending to have, no doubt, much correspondence and meetings with the UK Government over the future of the levelling up funds. I would just pick up on one point the member made. My comments were not whatsoever in relation to the downplaying the merits of the Fair Isle Award. I was simply making a point that out of all the islands and islands, of a £4.8 billion project in the most recent round of funding, that was the only award. I mean, my constituency apparently doesn't deserve any levelling up funding, even though if you look at the economic social stats, it should qualify for that kind of funding. And many parts of the Highlands would have done so under the European funding, which the levelling up funding was partly to replicate. But of course, the Highlands and Islands were deemed low priority under the UK Government's criteria, whereas when we were in Europe, they were deemed high priority. But the final point I just make to the member is that, of course, this is a fund largely delivered, if not wholly, through local government in Scotland, and she may wish to speak to our local authority about their discussions with the UK Government over the future rounds of the Levelling Up Fund. But I'll certainly pass on her point to my colleague Neil Gray to ensure that's incorporated.
And briefly answer that one.
Despite previously benefiting enormously from EU funding, does the Minister share my view that the Western Isles receive nothing in either round of the Levelling Up Fund, and my view that the apparent determination of the UK Government to ignore the devolution settlement is unhelpful, and that structural funds should be devolved to the Scottish Government as a priority?
Minister.
Well, again, the member makes a good point, because originally, of course, the Scottish Government were led to believe there would be a consequential £400 million for the Scottish Government to allocate in tandem with Scottish priorities, and then at the last moment the UK Government changed their mind and decided to allocate the whole of the fund across the UK according to their own criteria, with the Scottish Government, or indeed the devolved administrations, having no meaningful say in the process whatsoever. And the idea that the Western Isles should not qualify for this funding, over £4.8 billion worth of funding, £4.8 billion worth of funding, when I expect later today this chamber will be debating the fragility of the Western Isles economy. And that fragility is recognised by this Scottish Government, it was recognised by the European Union, but it's not been recognised by the UK governments.
Question number four, Annabel Ewing.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its vision for solar energy.
Minister Gillian Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government published a draft vision for the future of solar energy in Scotland as part of our Draft Energy Strategy and Just Transition Plan. The consultation on this plan has now closed, and we're reviewing the many responses and evidence received, and we expect to publish the final solar vision by the end of 2023.
Annabel Ewing.
I thank the Minister for her answer, and the Minister will be, of course, aware of the repeated calls that have been made for the setting of a stretching but achievable target for solar power, because, of course, that is seen as a sine qua non to unlocking the huge potential of solar power in Scotland to secure the just transition that, of course, we all wish to see. So could I ask the Minister if she is sympathetic to these calls for the setting of a stretching but achievable target?
Minister.
I thank Annabel Ewing for that question. I absolutely hear those calls, and solar, as I said, was a key part of the Energy Strategy and Just Transition draft plan. Through this consultation, we invited stakeholders to provide their views on setting a solar deployment ambition and to submit evidence to support this. Now, as I said, the consultation is now closed, and we're reviewing the responses. We're going to provide an updated position on that by the end of 2023. On where we see that ambition, and the associated targets will be set out. To date, there are 400 megawatts being generated through solar PV systems, with 375 megawatts in the pipeline. But I agree, we can do much more.
A couple of brief supplementaries. First, Liam Kerr.
Very grateful. We share the Minister's ambition for solar, but it's important that our energy mix and targets are based on evidence and data. So at what temperature does the government's modelling show a reduction in solar panel output begins? And as temperatures increase as a result of climate change, what source will provide continuous, constant power to compensate?
Minister.
Well, as Liam Kerr will know, an energy, and has said, is that an energy mix is really, really important. That's why we've invested so much in ScotWind, and I think that wind and solar are actually compatible. When the wind is blowing, it tends to be that the sun isn't shining. We'll know that from living in the northeast in particular. And you'll actually see some developments actually happening. For example, I was speaking to the Scottish Power, who own Whiteley, and they're actually combining solar panels with their wind farm capabilities as well, because in recognition of that fact. So he's right. I mean, we do need to look at energy mix in the round, but I think wind and solar are absolutely eminently compatible.
And briefly, Sarah Boyack.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Given the huge opportunities there are for solar in both our urban and our rural communities, will the Minister consider looking at least a 4-gigawatt target, given the evidence we got at the cross-party group on energy efficiency and renewables last night, which is really positive? But we need that support for existing and new homes, buildings and solar farms, given the biodiversity and rural impacts they could have
across the country?
I thank Sarah Boyett for that. And I absolutely recognise the level of ambition that there is in the solar sector. And Solar Energy Scotland, they have requested that the Scottish Government set a target of 4 gigawatts with an upper ambition of 6 gigawatts. And of course, we're absolutely looking at that. But they're also, Scottish Renewables have also called for a target of 1 gigawatt in public sector buildings. And I think that we've actually really got the potential, particularly when we look at our public buildings, to be putting solar on a lot of them. Obviously, a lot of local authorities are making that decision right now. My own local authority in Aberdeenshire are actually providing solar panels for those that live in the local authority houses. So there is a real potential there, working in partnership across local government and Scottish Government, and obviously with our partners in the sector.
Thank you. Question number 5 isn't lodged. Question 6, Jamie Green.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what support it is providing to tourism and other businesses within island communities to mitigate the impact of any connectivity issues affecting them.
Minister Richard Lockhead.
We understand the critical interdependence between ferries, the tourism sector and businesses across our islands. And any scheme for additional support along the lines suggested by the member for businesses, of course, needs to be carefully considered and would require stark choices to be made about funding priorities set against efforts to provide resilience in the network. However, the Scottish Government has already given a commitment to look into this further.
Jamie Green.
The Scottish Government has had plenty of time to look into this because the ferry fiasco that our islands face now is not a recent event. It's been happening for some years already, and it is hotels, restaurants, shops, cafes, caravan sites, cycle hire businesses, you name it, even our amazing breweries. They're all suffering, they're losing money, and they're losing customers right now. So I'd like to ask the Minister, what analysis has the Scottish Government already done on the economic cost that this ferry crisis is costing our island communities, and why won't they commit to the immediate launch of a compensation fund so that these businesses can get back on their feet right now?
Minister.
Of course, Parliament will have an opportunity to debate this later today, and we do not underestimate in any shape or form the impact of the ferry disruptions on the economies of our islands, and particularly, as the member says, in terms of tourism and local businesses. And that's why the focus up to now has been on ensuring we can build a resilient ferries network to ensure we can get to the root of the issue facing islands and sort it. But, as I also said, the Government is currently exploring other options to see if we can support where appropriate. And the First Minister, of course, commented on that last week in the Chamber. In the meantime, there are many other ways in which the Scottish Government is supporting the islands, £26 million to support the National Islands Plan, including £4.1 million this year, rural rates relief, £50 million through the Islands Growth Deals, our rural delivery plan we're committed to, and also through R100 we installed 16 new subsea fibre cables leading to 15 islands, which is also crucial for tourism businesses and other businesses. So we are doing a lot to help the islands' economies, but we recognise, of course, there are particular pressures just now.
Question number 7, Emma Harper.
To ask the Scottish Government how it is ensuring that rural communities, including Dumfries and Galloway, benefit from current and future renewable energy projects.
Minister Gillian Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Community benefits are a well-established integral part of renewable energy developments in Scotland, enabling all communities to benefit from our vast energy, natural energy resources. CARES, our Community and Renewable Energy Scheme, provides grants and loans which help communities to benefit from the transition to net zero. And CARES also provides impartial support and advice about community benefits and shared ownership schemes. And we've commissioned independent research that will help us ensure that our policies, advice and our funding continue to deliver benefits to communities across Scotland, and that research is due to report this summer.
Emma Harper.
Thank the Minister for that response. Many areas across Scotland benefit from renewable energy projects, and some of these projects can lead to regeneration of derelict areas, as well as bringing training opportunities and highly skilled, highly paid jobs to the area for local people. There is a potential for an offshore development near Luce Bay called SW1 in the Solway Firth. However, one of the challenges is attracting investment in the project is engaging people regarding the potential benefits of that could come to Stranraer and Wigtonshire. So can the Minister indicate whether the Scottish Government is doing any work to inform communities about how they could benefit from such energy projects?
Minister.
I thank Emma Harper for that question. The Scottish Government works closely with partners, including Local Energy Scotland, to increase communities' awareness and understanding of the opportunities presented by renewable energy projects, including the potential for shared ownership and community benefits. Our long-standing community and renewable energy scheme provides impartial support, advice and funding to communities to make the most of the opportunities and to realise some of the ambition that the communities may have themselves. Our good practice principles clearly set out the need for developers to engage with local communities early and extensively on renewable energy proposals. I've been having really positive conversations with various developers on how they can improve their engagement and be inventive on the type of community benefits that they actually offer, which will have a real positive impact on people's lives. Emma Harper will know that the Fleece and Galloway to date has benefited from around £4.6 million in community benefits.
Thank you. And question number 8, Alistair Allen.
To ask the Scottish Government what discussions it has had with the UK Government regarding... sorry, I beg your pardon. Whether it will provide an update on the uptake in the Western Isles of R100 Scottish Broadband Voucher Scheme vouchers worth up to £5,000 for properties for which there is no rollout of superfast broadband plan.
Minister Richard Lockhead.
The R100 plan involves rolling out superfast broadband to as many properties in the Western Isles as possible. Currently, superfast broadband coverage on the Western Isles now stands at 80.5%, up from just 1.3% in 2014. This is in large part due to public funded investment through the Digital Scotland Superfast Broadband Programme. The R100 Scottish Broadband Voucher Scheme is demand-led, and as yet no vouchers have been claimed in the Western Isles. However, the R100 team is in advanced talks with commercial operators with a view to them becoming registered suppliers for the Western Isles.
Alistair Allen.
I thank the Minister for his reply. A number of my constituents have recently expressed concern that some of the companies listed on the R100 website as being active in the Western Isles and so able to utilise R100 vouchers are declining to undertake this work when approached by interested residents. So can I ask what more could be done to ensure that it is made clearer which companies will do the work in the islands to ensure that people use the voucher they are entitled to?
Minister.
Well, I think Alistair Allen is quite correct that the situation clearly needs to improve and improve quickly. And I can just assure him that there are advanced talks underway with a number of suppliers with a view to them becoming registered on R100 schemes. And I'm confident those talks will ultimately yield a positive outcome for the Western Isles. But I just want to assure him I'm going to keep a very close eye on this, and I'm happy to discuss with him at any point the specific obstacles that his constituents are facing in terms of taking advantage of the vouchers. And we're exploring as a government many other options as well, because as we all know, technology is moving on quickly, and I'm very keen as a relatively new minister for this portfolio to understand very, very quickly how we can take advantage of these new technologies for our island communities in Scotland.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes portfolio questions on wellbeing, economy, fair work and energy. There will be a brief pause before we move on to the next portfolio to allow the front benches to change. Okay, the next portfolio is finance and parliamentary business. As ever, if a member wishes to ask a supplementary, I'd invite them to press the request to speak button during the relevant question. There is quite a lot of interest in this portfolio, so again, I'd appeal for succinct questions and indeed responses. I call question number 1, Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you. Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has made of the impact of the 2023-24 budget on the ability of local authorities to keep support and leisure facilities open to the public.
Minister Joe Fitzpatrick.
Apologies. Thank you, President Officer. The Scottish Government places great importance on sport and leisure facilities and believes everyone should have access to these services. We've increased the resources available to local government in 2023-24 by more than £793 million, a real terms increase of £376 million, or 3% compared to the 2022-23 budget figures. But, Presiding Officer, that doesn't take away from the challenges faced by all public services in the light of years of austerity, the cost of living crisis and sky-high energy prices. But it is for local authorities to manage their own budgets and to allocate the total financial resources available to them on the basis of local needs and priorities.
Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you for that answer. Reduction in local government budgets have forced pools and leisure centres to pass on the cost of running them to the clubs and customers that use them. We cannot allow swimming pools to become unaffordable and let involvement of enthusiasm in Scotland's highest participation sports decline. The UK government recently announced a £63 million fund specifically to support swimming pools in England. Does the minister recognise the value of swimming pools, and can they tell us what Barnett consequences are to be made available to local authorities from this?
Minister.
Thank the member for his question. Local sport leisure facilities, including swimming pools, are vital in supporting the physical and mental health of the nation, and we've repeatedly called on the UK Government to use all of the powers at its disposal to tackle the cost of living crisis and provide appropriate energy bill reliefs to leisure facilities, particularly to indoor water and ice facilities where energy is absolutely crippling. So following the announcement of the UK Government of the financial package to support swimming pools in England, we are considering what support, including ensuring the longer-term sustainability and energy facilities of these energy efficiency of these facilities can be provided to the sport and leisure sector in Scotland. Many local authorities, many leisure facilities have taken action in order to reduce energy costs, but this is really, really challenging. So really call on the UK Government to step up and support the leisure facilities, particularly indoor water and ice.
Briefly, Douglas Lumsden.
Presiding Officer, this morning the Petitions Committee heard evidence about swimming pools closing right across Scotland. Vibrant, packed community hubs like Bucksburn and Aberdeen shut because the SNP administration slashed the sports budget. And as we heard, there is money from the UK Government to fund swimming pools. So, Minister, today, will you tell us when this money will be allocated? Because some of that needs to be used to get Bucksburn swimming pool back open again.
Minister.
I think that the member is again trying to make the Scottish Government take decisions for local authorities. Local authorities are elected on their own democratic
merit. Minister, could you resume your seat? Mr Lumsden, I invited you to ask a supplementary question. I didn't invite you to then provide the answer. Let the Minister be heard. Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Local authorities have their own democratic mandate in order to determine how they dispose of the funding that comes to them. Obviously, any money that comes to the Scottish Government in relation to Barnett consequentials will be dispersed in the usual way as part of the budgeting process, and I think that's absolutely appropriate. I think I've already said that we are considering whether there are further financial support that the Scottish Government wants to take in terms of supporting those facilities. I think swimming pools and ice are two particular areas where the energy costs are absolutely crippling. The UK Government have the powers and can take action to support these facilities now.
Question 2, Annie Well.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it has conducted any modelling on the potential behavioural impact of the Scottish Green Party's proposal to introduce a new increased tax rate for those earning between £75,000 and £125,000.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government is aware of the risks and benefits arising from behavioural responses to policy proposals and actively works with stakeholders such as HMRC to monitor and continually improve the evidence base to help inform policy development. As a standard practice, any planned changes to Scottish income tax will be announced during the regular annual budget process. Our approach to taxation will continue to be guided by the strategic objectives and principles set out in the framework for tax, which underpins our fair and proportionate approach.
Annie Wells.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Under the SNP, Scotland is already the highest taxed part of the UK. Hundreds of thousands of Scottish workers pay more tax for doing the same job as people south of the border. That impacts teachers, police officers and NHS staff. If the SNP plan to increase taxes even more, especially if they listen to the extreme Green Party, it could drive people away. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree that it would be reckless to increase tax so high that it ends up raising less money to support public services?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, firstly, based on the latest forecast published by the Scottish Fiscal Commission, we calculate that 52% of taxpayers in Scotland will pay less income tax than they would in the rest of the UK. And, of course, the SFC is an independent organisation. But in terms of the money, of course, that is raised, we estimate that the income tax policy changes announced for 2023-24 alone will add £519 million to the Scottish budget. And that, of course, is additional money to spend on public services, some of which we heard calls for earlier on. And, of course, it supports individuals, households and the economy. So, you know, if the Tories are saying that they want lower personal taxation, that they want lower business taxation, but they want higher spending on public services, then they are suggesting a financial model, Presiding Officer, that exists nowhere in the world. So I think they need to come clean and tell us what their position is. If it's lower tax and higher spending, how does that work?
I've got a number of supplementaries. They will need to be brief, as will the responses. First, Ross Grier.
Thank you. The first time the Greens and SNP worked together to make progressive changes to income tax was 2018. The Tories claimed then that it would result in a flight of high-income taxpayers south of the border. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, is there any evidence that that actually happened? And how much money has been raised for our essential public services as a result of those progressive tax changes?
Cabinet Secretary.
So in December 2021, we published a policy evaluation of the income tax reforms implemented in 2018-19, which showed limited evidence of Scottish taxpayers lowering their taxable income in response to increasing tax rates. Our analysis also suggests that the policy raised between £230 million and £245 million that year, compared to implementing rates and bans applicable elsewhere in the UK. In December 2023, the Scottish Fiscal Commission estimated that our income tax policy will raise £1 billion of additional revenue in 2023-24 compared to had we matched the UK government. And of course, that is the money put at risk by the Tory policy. And finally, Presiding Officer, Scotland continues to see consistent positive net inward migration from the rest of the UK. On the latest available figures, that was around 10,000 people, which of course we welcome.
Briefly, Bill Kidd.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the DFM tell us how much tax revenue would have been lost from the budgets that pay for the NHS, schools and all the other public services if the Scottish Government had copied the UK Government, as the Tories demanded, and cut tax for the wealthiest?
Briefly,
well, as I said earlier, the modelling done by the Independent Scottish Fiscal Commission, they found that had we done as the Tories asked and matched the UK policy in 2023-24, let me repeat, Scotland would be £1 billion worse off. That's £1 billion stripped from the NHS, from schools, from social services, from councils, including covering things like swimming pools, Presiding Officer, to provide a tax cut to the better off. That is what the Tories wanted us to do. Thankfully, we didn't do that.
And briefly, Michael Mara.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We were told just a year ago that the resource spending review is absolutely critical to these questions of our public finances. But yesterday, Shona Robson came to Finance Committee and told us that the plans for reducing the size of the public sector to pre-COVID levels had been scrapped. Can she tell Parliament today, has the resource spending review been scrapped in its entirety? Does it form any part of government policy anymore? Because on the 23rd of June last year, she said it will bring to life their policy agenda. Is it life being killed off entirely?
Cabinet Secretary.
No, it won't be, but like any other government, we have to take account of key elements that change. So, for example, the negative tax reconciliation that we now know we have to deal with next year, caused by, of course, the forecast due to COVID-19 at that time. We also have to deal with the inflation-led pay deals. We did not know that inflation was going to be at the height that it is, and that, of course, has driven pay deals that go well beyond what was budgeted for. And, of course, we have to deal with all of the other inflationary pressures that are on the budget, and then we have to make room, of course, for spending on social security and health. So the RSR, of course, remains important, but what I set out in the medium-term financial strategy was a plan to deal with all of those challenges. What we need to hear from Labour is whether they'll back us on those plans.
Question number three, Stephanie Callaghan.
to ask the Scottish Government what funding has been allocated in the Scottish Budget 2023-24 to tackle child poverty.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Budget includes £405 million for our game-changing Scottish child payment and £83.7 million for discretionary housing payments to mitigate the UK Government's policies, including the benefit cap. We continue to invest around £1 billion in the provision of funded early learning and childcare, and will make £108 million available for employability support, enabling increasing services for parents who are both out of work and in low-income employment. Our latest Tackling Child Poverty Progress report, published this week, estimates that £3 billion was invested across a range of programmes targeted at low-income households, with £1.25 billion directly benefiting children.
Stephanie Callaghan.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Last week, a report by End Child Poverty, titled Local Indicators of Child Poverty After Housing Costs 21-22, highlighted that the unacceptable levels of child poverty that remain across the UK are likely to worsen due to the devastating impact of the Tory-driven cost of living crisis. Whilst investment within its fixed budget by the Scottish Government and initiatives such as the Scottish Child Payment, alongside the newly established cash-first approach to tackling food insecurity, is welcome, what fiscal levers would the Scottish Government require to enable it to truly alleviate the pressing issue of child poverty?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, of course, Stephanie Callaghan is quite right to point to the Tory-driven cost of living crisis that underpins the challenge that many families are facing with their household budgets at this time. Analysis published on Tuesday with our Child Poverty Progress report estimates that 90,000 fewer children will live in relative and absolute poverty this year as a result of Scottish Government policies, with poverty levels 9% lower than they would otherwise have been. And we're determined to do everything we can to provide help to those who need it within the scope of our limited powers and fixed budget. And as I've just outlined, this includes mitigating UK Government actions. But we want to do more than mitigate, Presiding Officer, and it's only with the full powers that this country needs, with the Government having all the levers over economic, social security and employment, including the minimum wage, to tackle poverty and inequalities, that we can truly do that. I know the Tories don't like to hear about poverty, but those are the facts.
Brief supplementary, Carol Moore.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Scottish councils have been informed at short notice via COSLA that the same level of funding provided for tackling holiday hunger programmes will not be offered this summer by this SNP government, this government. This simply confirms they are willing to stretch local government budgets further and further. Can the Cabinet Secretary commit to matching last year's funding, ensuring tackling child poverty and hunger programmes that local councils across Scotland had already planned can go ahead?
As briefly as possible, Cabinet
Secretary.
Well,
as the member knows, because the Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice told the Chamber yesterday that our funding package to local authorities includes targeted support for eligible families during the school holidays throughout the school year, and we've provided local authorities with £21.75 million to support free school meals for eligible families during the school holidays during this academic year. And this, of course, is available to families who are eligible for free school meals on the basis of low income, regardless of the age of their children, and councils have the flexibility to put in place any approach or approaches that meet local needs and circumstances.
Question 4, Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it plans to propose a parliamentary debate on sewage.
Minister George Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Any proposals for government business in Parliament are agreed by the Scottish Cabinet, subject to consideration by the Parliamentary Bureau and in turn approved by the Parliament.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
I'm very grateful for that reply, but I'm not sure that was an answer. There was a lack of urgency in the Minister's response, and that lack of urgency characterises their whole approach to this issue. It is an urgent issue. It's urgent to our constituents. Every day, thousands upon thousands of gallons of sewage are purposefully dumped in our rivers and our waterways. Yet it has been 18 months since we had a meaningful government statement on this matter. The only debate held in parliamentary time was in a members' business debate in my name. And I think it's about time the Scottish Government got to grips with the importance this means for our constituents. And I ask him, will he think again and schedule a debate on sewage?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I am aware of Mr Cole-Hamill's feelings on this matter, and I continue to try and be helpful with him and suggest that he possibly take this up with the Minister, Government Minister Mary McAllen. Normally, I would say take it up with your business manager, but I know in your case that might be quite difficult. But of course, the member has mentioned and is aware that the topic was debated in October 2022, and the former Minister for Environment and Land Reform gave a ministerial statement in December 2021.
Question 5, Liz Smith.
To ask the Scottish Government what action it will take to address the negative revenue reconciliation of £687 million for 2024-25 that is currently forecast by the Scottish Fiscal Commission.
Cabinet Secretary.
The forecast negative reconciliation of £687 million is driven by a large income tax reconciliation of £712 million, offset by other Social Security and devolved tax block grant adjustments. To be clear, the large variance to initial forecasts is a consequence of the COVID-19 pandemic impacting forecast income tax receipts and associated block grant adjustments in 2021-22. As the reconciliation crystallises in 2024-25, this contributes to an extremely challenging funding outlook next year. And of course, I don't have the adequate tools under the current fiscal framework to manage this impact because it exceeds our borrowing limits by almost £400 million. As set out in the medium-term financial strategy, I'm planning on the basis of maximising resource borrowing to address this negative reconciliation, and the upcoming fiscal framework review must address this limited fiscal flexibility and provide the tools needed to manage this volatility.
Thank you. I'm going to need shorter responses. Supplementary, Liz Smith.
The Cabinet Secretary at Finance Committee yesterday admitted that as a result of this negative reconciliation, combined with the projected increases in Scottish Government expenditure, particularly in relation to Social Security, that the outlook for the Scottish budget is particularly challenged. And she also admitted that this would require the Scottish Government to make very difficult decisions. And when I asked her about that, she said that there are 500 different projects that the Scottish Government is reviewing. So given the seriousness of the budget situation and the need for urgent action, can I ask the Cabinet Secretary when she'll be able to provide Parliament with the information that the Finance Committee is requesting in order to pursue its budget scrutiny?
Cabinet Secretary.
So first of all, can I say that, of course, that the position for 2024-25 is not helped by a real terms cut to both revenue and capital funding from the UK government. So that would help if Liz Smith has any influence in that regard. In terms of the review and targeting, as I set out in some detail yesterday, we are working through a whole programme of looking at every area of government in terms of all the programmes, in terms of whether they, how far they go in meeting the core missions set out by the First Minister a few weeks ago. That process will then lead in very directly to the budget process for 24-25, and we will set all of that out and we'll engage with the Finance Committee in the normal manner and provide the Finance Committee with as much detail as it becomes available. But Liz Smith will understand that that process will take some time to come to its conclusion.
And very briefly, Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Premier Officer. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree that this negative reconciliation is yet another clear example of why it's so important that the revised fiscal framework provides the Scottish Government with the budget levers commensurate to addressing the volatility that the Scottish budget is exposed to?
Briefly, Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, our current borrowing powers are limited in scope and, of course, being eroded over time by inflation. And as a result, we must manage this large reconciliation in a single financial year at a time where our resource borrowing is capped at £300 million. So the upcoming fiscal framework review must rectify this and ensure the Scottish Parliament has sufficient levers to deal with challenges such as these.
Question 6, Rose McCall.
To ask the Scottish Government how the planning system can help to create a strong, prosperous and vibrant retail sector, including through business support.
Minister Joe Fitzpatrick.
The planning system has a vital role to play in supporting the retail sector. National Planning Framework 4 encourages proposals that improve and enhance the vibrancy of a city, town and local centres. That includes a town centre first approach to encourage retail in sustainable locations. We've also introduced changes to permitted development rights and the use classes order to provide more flexibility for different uses, including retail, in city and town centres. Alongside this, we're working with partners to take forward actions in the Town Centre Action Plan and our Retail Strategy for Scotland.
Rose McCall.
Thank you for the response. The structure and nature of Scottish retail has changed over the decades, The prominence of physical retail stores in our towns and shopping centres gradually declining, and the rise of social venues such as cafes and eateries. I recently visited Kingsgate Shopping Centre in Dunfermline, where the management highlighted the significant financial cost imposed by Fife Council on those who wish to reflect these changes by changing their business category from one retail to category three in hospitality. So can the Minister outline what more the Scottish Government can do to lessen these costs for businesses and how the planning system can greater reflect these changes of nature in retail?
As briefly as possible, Minister.
Thank you very much for the really important question. One of the challenges that we hear from business and planning authorities across Scotland is in terms of ensuring they have the resource to deal with planning applications speedily. Part of ensuring that resource is about making sure it's properly funded. So we did recently increase the fees that planning authorities can charge, and that has allowed planning authorities up and down the country to potentially retain or employ new staff. I think there's a balance here, but I think the thing that business often says most important is they get a speedy resolution to planning applications.
Question 7, Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what discussion the Finance Secretary has had with ministerial colleagues regarding any impact of its fiscal policy platform will have on businesses, including tourism and hospitality.
Minister Tom Arthur.
The Cabinet Secretary for Finance and I regularly discuss fiscal policy with our ministerial colleagues. This includes the impacts on a range of sectors, including tourism and hospitality. We are committed to supporting sustainable and inclusive economic growth and will focus on economic policies and actions with the greatest potential to grow and strengthen Scotland's economy.
Alexander Stewart.
I thank the Minister for that response. The Scottish tourism sector has faced a catalogue of poorly thought through policies that threaten to seriously undermine the success of tourism and hospitality businesses. The short-term let scheme, the tourist tax and the utter failure of our infrastructure such as ferries and the A9 are SNP thorns in the side of Scottish tourism. At a time when the sector has asked for time to recover, why has the SNP ignored them and pushed ahead with a string of burdensome priorities causing distress and worry to businesses throughout Scotland?
Minister.
We engage very closely with representatives of the tourism sector across a range of issues, including through our work on the New Deal for Business. We have delivered across a range of infrastructure projects over our time in government, whether that be the completion of the M74, the completion of the M8, the completion of the M80, the Aberdeen Western Peripheral Road, the Queensferry Crossing, and a range of other activities which would have benefit to the tourism sector and other businesses across Scotland. And indeed, as we take forward our proposals for a visitor levy, we will be continuing to engage very closely with business.
And briefly, John Mason.
Thank you. Last week we debated tourism, and it was very clear then that energy costs, inflation and Brexit labour shortages require action by the London Government. Has the Minister had any engagement with them, either for the UK to take action or to give Scotland these powers?
Minister.
I agree that the Scottish Government have much greater freedom to support the tourism sector, which is vital to the Scottish economy with the full powers of independence. The tourism sector is in need of more support, but we are constrained by the limited fiscal levers we currently control. This is why we continually urge the UK Government to go further with their reserve tax powers, specifically highlighting that a reduced rate of VAT is a consistent ask from stakeholders, and we will continue to urge the UK Government to do more to support Scottish businesses.
Question 8, Richard Leonard.
Deputy Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the recent Accounts Commission report, Local Government in Scotland, Overview 2023.
Minister Joe Fitzpatrick.
Thank you. The Scottish Government welcomes the findings of the Local Government in Scotland, Overview 2023 report. The report rightly points to the pressures on the public finances, but also confirms that despite over a decade of UK government austerity, local authority revenue funding has increased by 2.6% in real terms between 2013-14 and 2023-24.
Richard Leonard.
Well, can I thank the Minister for that response? But the Minister cannot ignore or wish away the evidence contained in this report. In adult social care, signs that the sector is in crisis, with growing backlogs, declining satisfaction and no clear picture of demand or unmet need. In housing, growing rent arrears, mounting voids, poorer maintenance performance, homelessness spiralling once again, culture and leisure, high risk of closures, unquote. Children's services, the poverty-related attainment gap remains larger than pre-pandemic levels. The list goes on. Does the Minister agree that the government must stop managing decline stop inflicting cuts onto the poorest communities and must start by introducing a tax on wealth.
Minister.
Thank the member for his question. I think we look forward to hearing the member's contributions to the budget, to any proposals. I know the Cabinet Secretary will be happy to listen to and engage if Labour have serious proposals. It will be a first, because I have been in this Parliament for 16 years, and I think there's been one serious proposal that would have given extra money to local government. That came for Alex Rowley from the Labour Party, and I don't think the Labour group supported it. This party couldn't support it at that time. We do not for a second underestimate the challenges that local government and other public services are facing.
Minister, could I ask both front benches to stop heckling the Minister while he's providing the answer? Minister, if you could be concluding.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. I could just hear chuntering, so I'm not sure what the sedentary point was. I think the member makes a good point, which is that we need to address these challenges, which is why we're working with COSLA on a new deal for local government. It's a co-produced piece of work, which I hope all of in this Parliament will sign up to recognise the democratic mandate that local government has. It's time to allow local government to have its space as one of the spheres of government in Scotland. This government is determined to do that, and I hope that the opposition will step up too.
Thank you very much. That concludes portfolio questions. There will be a brief pause to allow front benches to change before we move on to the next item of business.